AOP process is a very good process.
Right.
And from our perspective, the SAS 70 is not a good process. It's a marketing given. And that's how it's being used, as a marketing tool by salespeople. And if folks out there buying services don't understand that, then they're really buying at a disadvantage.
And I wouldn't, you know, Bill was talking about regulation and auditing. I would never sign the contract unless I had the right to audit. It's non-negotiable. Not that I'm going to.
But that only comes with size. Most middle-tier companies find that they really don't have.
They don't have hands, sure.
They don't have the clout.
Actually, we had a situation where I sent one of our network administrators out to a training course, and there was like a dozen different locations in the United States where this course was being held. We selected the location where they were hosting our internet banking service because what I wanted them to accomplish when he was out there for the training was to see if he could get a tour of the data center and see what type of monitoring equipment they have, security capabilities, access controls. They obliged. They were very happy to give him a private tour, and we were very pleased with that. And it goes back to the partnership and the relationship.
Well, I think they're going to have to become much more customer-oriented regarding security to be successful over the next couple of years.
And we're a small and medium business.
Somebody brought up the Cloud Security Alliance. What percentage of the industry participates in the Cloud Security Alliance? Do you have any idea? Membership is the Cloud Security Alliance.
There's thousands of people, I believe, who are participating in the CSA. And again, they're incorporating other standards like the OWASP standard. So if you have a large web front end, that to me would be, and you should be allowed to do pen tests or confidently get results that would show that they were specifically tested against the OWASP top 10 list and that they were, they were load tested, that they knew that there were reasonable benefits, that it wasn't cross-script hacking, that there wasn't buffer overflows. And again, if you say to them, are you certified to the OWASP top 10 list, and they look at you with blank eyes, I would walk out the door. I would do a 180 and go out. So you need to know, they're buzzwords, but if they don't even understand the buzzwords, you're really not working with somebody who's sensitive to your concerns.
You also have to partner with them. A lot of these cloud firms are small, they're new, they're just getting into the space. We found, working with them, we would come in and say, look, we want to do a pen test with you, and we'll share everything with you, so that you can make your product better, so that not only are you doing this to get our business, but you're actually getting some free consulting from, our viewpoint, in terms of how secure your apps are. Found a very good uptake on that, especially with the smaller vendors, because when you first go to them and say, well, where's your SAS 70? A lot of these vendors, they're not, they have not yet gotten to that point in their growth where they've decided to spend that money to get that done. So we sort of work with them to come up with a pathway where we say, okay, we'll do some pen testing with you. Here we'll share some of our controls that we use and say, here's how we do it, here's how we would expect you to do it. If you make it a partnership with them, that seems to work really well. It's much harder to do that with a larger, more established organization, but on the smaller ones it does work well. The other thing to remember also about the SAS 70 is that it was never designed to do what we're making it do. The SAS 70 was originally designed so that if you are outsourcing an activity that affects your financial bottom line, that this is, the SAS 70 was providing assurance, of sort of the financial aspects of that, and it's sort of been forced into this other role that it never should have had. And actually to this day, I believe the AICPA doesn't really sort of officially recognize the use of the SAS 70 for probably 90% of people are using it for. I keep hoping every year that we'll see more of a move towards the ISO standards and more of an objective set of criteria for this. But I think we're sort of stuck with SAS 70 and its successors for a while to come.
But in a at a minimum, you should be asking the vendor what standards they measure themselves against and what their compliance is with that standard.
Well, yeah, we actually do a mapping in our SAS 70 that we provide to clients. We map against the ISO 25,000 series controls. You know, we don't do an official ISO audit at this point because we haven't really had, you know, the call for that. But we've had a number of organizations that just find it helpful to say, oh, well, here are all the controls that are set forth, and here are the portions of the SAS 70 where we address these controls. And we've also found it to be a good tool to sort of keep us honest and say, okay, we're really covering all of the areas that we would want to see if the SAS 70 was coming to us.
Yeah. Do any of you also map to NIST standards, which are more granular than ISOs?
So, yeah, I mean, I believe that all servers should be following the NIST guidelines, and should, so should routers. So, again, or this, it's the CSI standard slash the NIST standard. They've melded. So, but yeah, and it doesn't mean that all those servers will have to match that, because, again, there's business reasons for not having 100% match, but somebody should be saying, we start with the most secure lockdown for a Windows 2003 or Windows 2008 server, and we have the following documented exceptions because of the business model that's in place. Okay, and we've locked. I'm willing to get a standard from anywhere I can get it. So I go to TechTarget for Windows services that should be run. Okay, because the NIST and the CSI are not clear about what Windows services should be run. So I can say I'm going to start off with a Windows server configured with the following services turned off. And it's a best practice. That's the best I can say. It's not a big standard, but it's a starting point. So at least somebody can't say it's Mike Frank's opinion, which it doesn't do the CSO any good to be, you know, composting. You say, I can take a standard from anywhere. As long as I'm working toward a standard, that's how you're going to get motion. I was a coxswain on a crew team. Where else can a short guy with a big mouth command guys twice his weight? And it was men's heavyweight eight, and my coach gave me the best advice I've used for a lot of years, which is it's better to have eight guys rowing in the wrong direction together, because then you can do a course correction. When eight guys are doing whatever they think is the right thing, that boat ain't going anywhere, all right? And so I would say the same thing. There's nothing perfect, and if you're as an ISO, which is our, I think our nature is to wait for perfection, the business, like I said, is gonna get away from you. You need to make a call. It may not be the best call, but work around it.
Good point to close. The appointed hour has arisen, and the moderator's job is to make sure that we stop talking when that time occurs. I hope all of you found this to be as useful as I did, and one idea that I came away with that I would like to see us implement is that it would be nice to have a short list of standards that map against a short list of applications.
UCF provides something like that. Unified compliance framework. And okay. I'm not pro or against it, but I just haven't seen that. But they have those matrices.
Excellent.